Hey everyone, we're back with a special video this time. We're going to talk about the Mendix native mobile builder, and with us is special guest Danny Roest.
Thank you, Danny, for joining us.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It's nice to be part of this video.
Super excited because you've got a lot of cool stuff to talk about with us. And but before we dive into that, can you tell us a bit about yourself and what you do at Mendix?
Yeah. So my name is Danny Roest, and I'm a product manager at Mendix, responsible for front end. And by front end, we mean building web apps, building mobile apps, or other types of experience. And I'm responsible for the roadmap, vision, strategy there.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, we've seen a lot of blogs by you. We've read a lot of them, so we're always super excited when you come out with new content because, to me, you always bring the good stuff, so to say.
thank
the
you.
New goodies.
We're doing our best. We have a great team that works very hard on delivering new things,
and it shows.
Yeah.
So, and today we've invited you, obviously, for a reason, and Paul mentioned it. It's the Mendix native mobile builder. And without going too much into depth, can you tell us what is it and why is it awesome?
Yeah, that's a very good question. last year we introduced low-code for native mobile, making native mobile app building much more simpler, more accessible, so that even non-technical developers can build real native mobile apps. And a part of that is always, you can build your model, but at some point you need to build your binaries, which you can upload to the App Store. And this is always a complex or painful or sometimes even frustrating part of mobile app development. And it's not even for non-tech developers, but even technical developers struggle with it. And you need to know Xcode, Android Studio, all these different version management, dependency management, ports, Gradle, all these kinds of things. A lot of complex technology, and that's also the part we wanted to make simple and really make that a low-code experience. Now, for that, we introduced a whole new UI for simplifying building your native mobile app. So really making it simple to build your binaries. Basically, you can also see it as an abstraction on top of Xcode or Android Studio. And so you don't need all these complex tools. You can, if you want to, we still enable you to build locally, but you can also use this tooling to build, and then you can build automatically in the cloud. So really supporting that whole process. The first time you also open it, you get a nice wizard where you can click next, next, next. You can configure all your settings, upload icons, flash screens, set permissions, configure push notifications, setting API keys, uploading fonts, all these things where you normally need to know how do I have to do this in Xcode or how do I have to do this in Android Studio. And we put that in one simple user interface. And then, so that the users can easily build their apps.
That sounds awesome. So I hear you saying no more Xcode, no more Android Studio. Is that... Like, we don't need Xcode anymore if we want to build an app for iOS now, a native app.
Now, for the last part, if you want to publish to the Apple App Stores, you will still need Xcode to upload the binary. But you do not need Xcode to fully configure the app anymore or the change configuration there. And you can really see the builder UI as an abstraction on top of Android Studio and Xcode, and it basically changes the underlying source code. And the source code is a React Native project, and that will be configured for the settings.
I think you already mentioned this, but it's not only like a user interface on top of the command line interface, because the native builder can do more, for example, uploading your splash screens and icons. What are some other things that the native builder does that the command line interface doesn't?
Basically, it does the UI does everything the command line can do and even more, but the command line still can be used to do over-the-air updates, and that's something we'll be changing. And that will also mean that we're phasing out the CLI at some point. So you won't need a command line interface anymore, and because you can fully configure it through the UI. We are looking to still make it possible to run some commands from the command line, but mostly it will be really about the UI, that you use the UI, you configure your app, then everything is committed, for example, to GitHub, and then you can integrate it in a pipeline. So the main focus will be at the UI that will create your configuration, basically.
Would there be any reason to use the command line interface anymore?
For now, you can still use it for over-the-air updates. But with Mendix 9, we'll change that mechanism so that when the mobile app connects to the runtime, which it always does at startup, it will then check for a new model. So when you make changes just to pages, logic, styling, it will automatically fetch the model from the runtime server. So you don't need additional support for code push, which we're currently using.
Okay.
So then you basically don't need the command line anymore.
Okay, cool.
That's also a big feature that you mentioned there, the over-the-air updates. What can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so still publishing to the App Store is still not as easy as two clicks. It becomes much more simpler now. You can easily build the binaries, but you have to upload it to both app stores. You need to wait for the approval, things like that. Now, what we already had with hybrid mobile is that once you deploy your new model to the cloud, to your on-premise runtime, Mendix mobile app at startup will automatically connect to your runtime, and it will then automatically fetch also the latest model changes. Mm-hmm. As like I said, if you make changes just to your application inside Studio Pro, so making changes of pages, styling, logic, or even the main model, this will automatically be picked up by your mobile app. And so making changes is literally, you make a change, you publish it to your cloud, and the mobile app is will be updated. Now, only if you do make changes that requires a new binary, so for example, you add new React Native modules, or you want to change some app settings, change the icon or splash screens, for example, or permissions, then you need to publish again to the app stores.
That makes sense. So, not only the binary itself supports over-the-air updates, but the Mendix native builder itself does too. Can you tell us a bit why that is so important?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's actually something I'm also really happy with. So we integrated it as part of Studio Pro, so you can launch the native builder UI as part of Studio Pro via project and then build native mobile app. But the tooling itself is separately, so it's a separate executable, which is also auto-updatable. So also it starts at startup, it checks, oh, are there new updates for me? So it can automatically update itself. Now, why did we do this? Now, mainly for two reasons. The first is, of course, we can continuously release new features to users. But the most important one is at some point, regulations will change. That app store requirements will change. So you need to update your mobile app. For example, new requirements for iOS 15, for example. But we don't want to, make it required for customers to then upgrade also their Studio Pro, because it's also a whole migration project. Mm-hmm. What happens now, just this part of your application, so the native builder UI, will be updated automatically. And then you will automatically get access to these latest features or requirements, so you can just update your native mobile app without having to update Studio Pro.
That is so powerful. So everybody, do you expect everybody will then always be working on the latest version of the mobile builder as well?
Yeah, you will automatically get the latest version.
Yeah, so it's a lot easier for you as well to maintain one version, so to say, of the native mobile builder.
Yeah. Yeah, of the UI we have to, but of course there are also things that are different versions of the source beneath.
Mm-hmm.
For example, we're currently on React Native 61, but later we'll be on, 63. We also have to account for that. So we do check, which version of the source code your app is on, that we also apply the right settings. And it could be that some settings are not available then for your source code. but we'll also give you the option to automatically update your source code.
Sounds like you've thought it all through.
Yeah.
We try to.
That's very good. I like that.
So, I want to dive a bit in the functionalities of the native builder. Can you, for example, create different builds for different environments?
That's a good question. Currently, it's not in there yet, but this is actually something we're working on. And what we'll have there is you can create like configuration profiles, and it could be, for example, for test acceptance and production, but it could also be, this is my Paul profile, or this is my Willem profile, because I'm testing something that the other developers are not testing. So really making it flexible.
Cool.
There we also made a distinction between like generic configuration and the more configuration-specific configuration. Mm-hmm. So that you can easily change it.
Makes me think of how Studio Pro works at the moment, where you have your own settings, but you also have the project settings that are generic for everybody.
Yeah,
it's really like that indeed.
Cool. And for example, at one of our customers, we use single sign-on a lot. Is that something that will be supported as well in the near future? Or is it already supported?
It is actually something we're working on. This is not that much related to the native build UI. It could be that at some point you need some changes in your binary, and then we could make that settings as part of the native build UI. But currently, we have our expert services. Eric Tenever from Expert Services created a solution for doing SSO on native mobile. Now, we are now working on that approach to productize it and release it to customers. Now, this module already we gave to a couple of customers as an example module, and we had at least more than 5 customers already implementing it successfully. But it's pure a module, so it's just Mendix. The only thing you would need in this case is set up deep linking. Yeah, so because when you open the browser, it deep links back to your mobile device. Now, for example, deep linking is something you can configure from the native builder UI.
Wow.
That's nice.
Very nice.
You mentioned in your in one of the previous questions that you use GitHub to store the files in a repository. Is that like a choice? Can we pick something else besides GitHub?
Currently not. So you can now use GitHub, public repositories or private, what most customers want. And because we're also integrating with Microsoft App Center, which is the service to build that requires also GitHub. And of course, we also need to do something around versioning, but we are looking into getting rid of these dependencies so that you can choose some other versioning system or don't even use a versioning system, that will just be stored on your local disk. And also to see if we can replace App Center, for example, with an in-house service. But it's still research. But definitely the GitHub part we want to get rid of, because you can build using App Center, but you can also build locally. And if you then also don't have a GitHub dependency, basically, you can fully build while being offline.
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
That's powerful. And I think you already answered our next questions. we had a question to ask about App Center. Why is that a dependency?
Yeah, so we don't want our customers, when they start building, to directly having to install Xcode or Android Studio. And so you need some mechanism to actually build the binaries based on the sources. So for that, we wanted to leverage a service, at least initially. And App Center is basically one of the most popular ones, which we could integrate with. That's why we chose them. But like I said, we're also investigating whether we can use an in-house service, so you don't even need an account or subscription at App Center. That's still very uncertain whether we're going to do that or not. We just started research on that.
Yeah,
I do like this approach, though, because it kind of feels like you've took the easy route, but it's also a route that takes you the farthest in the shortest amount of time. So you can experience, get hands-on experience with the repo, with building your App Center, etc. So I think that's a good choice.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, you always want to give new functionality as soon as possible, but also having a path going forward.
Yeah,
that's also why we first released a command line. It's not because we think that was the low code way, but it was the fastest way to make it possible to build a native mobile app.
Mm-hmm.
Else you could only build an app and just test it and you make it native app. Now we put the UI on top of it and now we're taking it to the next step.
I'm not sure if you're allowed to, but can you maybe, what's the next big thing coming up for the native mobile builder, according to you?
Yeah, of course, I don't want to tell all the secrets.
just one.
one.
Now, for app building, we're really looking also for feedback there. So what's missing there on settings. So in that sense, we're looking to take feedback and based on that also determine next features. I think the configuration one is a big one. And also the dependency removal. If we can remove the whole dependencies of GitHub and App Center, I think that will help a lot of customers. So not a big thing here yet.
But still very, very useful. And that's kind of the thing I was looking forward to as well.
Yeah, and we'll definitely keep improving it also in the next year. And like I said, based on feedback, more settings, more variations, while still keeping it simple, of course. Yeah, and also support all these enterprise use cases indeed where customers say, yeah, we don't want to use or we cannot use GitHub. To make that easy.
You mentioned feedback. How can we get in touch if we have any feedback about the native builder?
Yeah, good question. So we have the forum, the ID forum, but also we see on the community Slack, we see much more traction there. So there we also have the native mobile channel, for example. So it would also be good to discuss there. At some point, if there are big topics you would like to discuss, you can also reach out, for example, to your partner manager or contact success or customer success manager. And we might also be able to schedule a meeting or so to go a bit more in depth.
Cool.
Yeah, very cool. So if this video got you as a developer excited, how would you recommend people get started with Manix Native Mobile Builder?
I would just start. Yeah, that sounds simple. Yeah, of course, the native mobile quick start app where you can already have a very plain app, play with it, run the builder, and try to get a build of yourself. It's always easiest to start with Android because you don't need certificates to already test with that. So yeah, we'll start with that in that case. But literally, yeah, you can set up with, in an hour, you could have built your own native mobile app. Now that's kind of cool without any technical expertise. And that's, I think, is really exciting.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, we already saw like people that have no computer science background, just more of a business tech-savvy background. They were like, whoa, we now made in such a short time, we created a full native mobile app. And that's that's something I'm still really proud of. And I think that's a really cool involvement.
Yeah, you should.
Yeah.
For sure.
Okay, so I think those were our questions. Is there anything that we might have missed and you want to share with us?
No, I think they were good questions, very complete. I think we told most about the new feature. I would definitely everyone recommend to try it out. I think very good. And thank you for having me, of course. It's really
thank
nice
you for
to,
being here.
Yeah, thank you. This part.
Yeah, it's really nice also to give this part a bit more attention because I do feel it's something special.
Yeah, we thought as well. This was such a big part of the release that we had to invite you over if you if you had time.
Yeah, so, feel free to invite me over more often if needed.
We'll definitely do that. Yeah.
Yeah. Don't worry about that.
So thank you very much for your time. And if you have any questions, like Danny already said, feel free to join the Manix community Slack. Send them a message in the Manix native channel and or the ID forum, anything goes. And I think this is a great new feature that is already great, but is such a big part of Mendix and will become even bigger, I think. So stay on the lookout.
Exactly. So thanks for watching. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and hope to see you at the next one.
Yes. See you soon.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.